Hallelujah. Good morning, good morning, good afternoon, people of God. Good afternoon. Hallelujah. Blessings, 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 folks. Come on in. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Oh, yes, God.
Jesus knows.
Thank you, Lord.
Just how much it costs you.
My God. Praise your wonderful name, oh God. Yes, hallelujah. Hallelujah. Yes, God.
To the broken
hearted. Hallelujah. He's a faithful God. Yes, thank you, Lord. Yes, God. Hallelujah. Bless your name, oh God. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. Yes.
From
oh, yes, God. Hallelujah. He's so good. He's so kind. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord. Hallelujah. Yes, God. Thank you, Lord. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. Oh, Jesus. He's so faithful. Yes, the Lord is so good. He's so good. He's so good. Hallelujah. As we learn worship, hallelujah, going from realm to realm, it's learning how to get beyond ourselves. Set our affections on the Lord. Focus our mind. Get everything else out of our mind. Get everything else empty out our hearts. And just begin to focus on the Lord. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Yes, God. Thank you, Lord. Oh, praise your wonderful name. Hallelujah. Glory to your name. Yes, God. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Yes, God. Hallelujah. Oh, Jesus. Thank you, Lord. My God. Thank you, Lord. Glory. Oh, Jesus. Yes, Lord. Oh, glory. Thank you, Lord. Oh, Jesus. Hallelujah. Oh, glory. Hallelujah. Praise your name, oh God. Thank you, Jesus. Ooh, glory. Come on. I love God and all his children. My God. Hey, glory. Come on. Hey, glory. Ooh, Jesus. Praise your name, God. Yes, Lord. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Glory. Oh, yes, God. Yes, God. Yes, God. Glory. Hallelujah. Praise your name, oh God. Thank you, Lord. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. You know what's so amazing in this season? I just heard the Lord say he's anointing his psalmist. He's anointing his psalmist. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. He's anointing his psalmist in this season. There are new songs being released from heaven. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. Hallelujah. He's anointing the ear to hear. There are new songs being released from heaven. Good morning, woman of God. Hallelujah. Praise your name, oh God. So thank you, not strange, as you begin to sing. And you might be singing a song that you know. And then something else come out. Just let it flow. Hallelujah. Just let it flow. Just let God be God. Thank you, Lord. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. Praise your name, oh God. Praise your name, oh God. He's so faithful. Ooh, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Glory. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Woo. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. See, my God is listening. The Lord will always confirm his word. The woman of God said it's happening. Come on. Glory. Thank you, Lord. Hallelujah. And see, lyrics are being released all the time. The Lord is giving downloads all the time. And the problem is that a lot of us are not willing to get uncomfortable to let God be God. We want to stick to the same old songs. We want to stick to the same lyrics. A lot of people, we get stuck in religion. We're going to sing this long and we ain't singing no longer. And what I've learned is that we have not learned how to truly elevate in the realms of glory, going from faith to faith and glory to glory, because we have to, it requires us to stay. We don't have enough endurance in worship. Two songs ain't going to break us out of 30 years of sin. I'm just trying to tell you the truth on today. My God, come on. We have to learn how to ascend in worship. It reminds me, I had it explained to me like this. Hallelujah. Praise the name of the Lord. It's like when you get in an airplane and you're ascending. Worship looks like this. We're ascending. We're going up. We're ascending. And we should get to a place in worship, but we got to break through all the atmospheres. And then once we get above the cloud, once we get at 10,000 feet, or how many feet they say, then they cut the engine off and the plane is able to coast. But we're cutting our engine off in worship too soon. And our worship leaders, God, I love your word on today. First of all, we got to have worship leaders that can endure to break through those realms. This is why that the Lord is desiring that we be in good health. Because you out of breath too soon. I'm just talking about me. We out of breath too soon. We can't last. We can't break through. We can't really do what we need to do in worship because our endurance is too short. So God is calling us. That's why it's time to get in shape. It's time to get healthy. It's time to turn that plate over. It's time to be able to learn to endure through worship. There are realms. If we truly understood the power of worship. As we were worshiping last night, we were here in Detroit, and I wanted to go live, but the Lord said it was intimate. So we did what we did, and we let the Lord begin to shift in the room. And I'm looking forward to what it is that the Lord does here tonight. But if we really understood the power of worship, we wouldn't handle it so loosely. If we truly understood the power of worship, we wouldn't handle it so loosely. So as we were in here worshiping last night, I heard the Lord. Let me see, I wrote it down. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. Praise your wonderful name. Thank you, Lord. Hallelujah. God is so faithful, y'all. He's so faithful. If we truly understood the power of worship. Oh, glory to your name. You know, it's so interesting. Look back. Think back over the history. Even if we think about how in slavery, they used to sing all the time. Baby, it's power in worship. It is power in worship. I promise you, it's very important for us to understand that worship is a kingdom privilege. It's a kingdom privilege, but it's also a kingdom key. And it opens doors and it closes doors. My God. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. I can't find where I wrote it down at. But as we were worshiping, the Lord was ministering about the importance of worship. And if we truly understand in this season, he said, keep my name in your mouth, not my name. Keep his name. That's what he said. Keep his name in your mouth in this season. My God. If we truly understood the power of worship, he said he is anointing the whisper in this season. He said any atmosphere that you step in that is unfruitful, that no, that's not what he said. Let me say it right because I want us to get the word, baby. I want us to get the word. He said any atmosphere that you walk in that looks like that it is not going to yield fruit, he said, whisper my name. My God. But the oil that is produced is in worship. Come on. And then the whisper is anointed. God, I love your word on today. And so many of us have not learned. We learned that one little darn. We got that one little praise break. But we have to learn how to ascend in worship and go a little higher in worship. Worship will break addiction off your back. Ask me how I know. Because I'm free. Come on. Worship will break temptation. God, I love your word on today. My God, worship will break those strongholds. God, I love your word on today. The Lord said this. He said, don't go to war without me. That's what he said. Don't go to war without me. God, I love your word on today. As we worship the Lord, the Bible says we must worship him in spirit and in truth. Hallelujah. We must not just worship him. He said your worship, it means nothing without a sacrifice. And as you begin to get into worship and you begin to get out of your own way and get out of your own head, and you have to learn how to empty out. Many, God, I love your word on today, have not entered into worship because it's over before you truly entered in. Because it's over before you truly entered in. Because we first got to empty out of our mind. We got to empty out of our mind. And when you ascend in worship, you got to go through levels. And you got to first empty out of your mind what you're about to do. You're rushing. You're this, that, you're third. All these things. You got to empty out of that first. Then you got to keep going into the realms. Then you will run into the accuser of the brethren every now and again. What does that mean? As I'm worshiping, the enemy will begin to bring up my past. Bring up how I'm not worthy. Bring up the sin that I did the day before. He will begin to bring up those things. The accuser of the brethren will reach you and meet you as you are ascending. But then you got to keep going. You got to keep going. And many of us, we cut off right there. Don't cut your engine off too soon. My God. If we truly understood the power of worship, we would do it differently. Hey, glory. See, what you have to understand is that the worship is for God, and the word is for you. The worship, it goes to God. That's what you bring. You bring your sacrifice to the altar. That's what you bring. And the word comes down, and it comes down to you. And so when you want the word, but you're not willing to give the worship, you want to rob God. My Lord. You're desiring to rob God, maybe out of ignorance, but now you know. So we have to learn how to ascend in worship. Worship is our tool. It's our warship. Come on. Where war happens, it's our vehicle of travel in the mind. I'm not telling you what I heard. I'm telling you how I live. This really true. When you begin to have warfare in your mind, if you ever learn how to break through realms in worship, and I hear this all the time, well, it's uncomfortable. You know, it's a block right there. I don't feel like I can do it. That's a ceiling. But you can't leave that moment until you break through. I was telling the women of God last night, I said, if it was $1 million on the roof, and I said, if you break through this ceiling in 5 minutes, you can get that $1 million. We're going to break through the ceiling. It's the same thing in worship. Well, that's not how I normally am. I'm not a loud worshiper. I'm just quiet. No, it's not true. You got to break through them realms. You got to get uncomfortable. I heard it said this way one time. You have to lose your cool to catch on fire. I love God and all of his children. My God, one of my spiritual daughters, listen, when I tell you, hey, glory, she just tickles my little soul. She tickles my little soul, y'all. So I've been trying to help her learn how to tarry for some time now. And so she said, I'm really going to do it because I'm holding back on God. I said, yeah, you are holding back on God. And once she really got into the presence, matter of fact, it was so funny. The Holy Ghost just fell because she kept yielding. She kept yielding. We actually came to, we went to the service in Thomasville. And listen, the Spirit of the Lord fell on her. She couldn't hold back no more. Baby girl cut a rug. I said, I had to fall back and let you just praise God by yourself. My God. But she had been yielding her heart, and she said, I don't know what happened to me. Listen, I'm trying to tell you on today, when you begin to break through those realms in worship, but a lot of times we're not taught this. I hate that we have been taught, my God, come on. We have been taught that the person, the worship leader, comes up front, they sing, and we sit down and just listen. Oh, we might stand up and we say, sing, girl. nope, you off. That's not the right response. My God, come on. We have to understand this, and we have to see that it's worship leaders are just leading. But at the end of the day, it's a personal altar right there. My God, come on. And where you at? This is a personal altar. The conversation is between you and God. I don't know if they singing good. I don't care if they singing good. Are you breaking through realms? Yes. My God. Yeah. Are you breaking through realms? See, some people, they sound good, and that's good. That's great. But if the Bible said it's the anointing that destroys yokes. Hey, God, I love your word on today. My God, and many of us we're not learning how to break through because we're worried about if it sounds good. Child, it don't matter if it sounds good. We're spending more time on choir rehearsal than we are on trying to tap into the Holy of Holies and maintain an altitude and last until the room is free, learning how to maneuver in the atmospheres. Come on, there's going to be turbulence. God, I love your word on today, but you have to learn how to hold tight and maintain so the whole plane don't go down in worship. My God, come on, as we are ascending, the Bible says we go from faith to faith and glory to glory. And we have settled for a sound good. We've settled for a good dun 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 dun. Let me tell you, woman of God, glory, the man of God that was there in Thomasville on them drums, he's anointed to play the drums. A lot of times I've seen in worship where the minstrels, the people that play the instruments, they're not even in tune with the spirit. But because they want to play, because they know how to play, we're letting them play. When one is in tune with the spirit, the music, the beating on the drums, the piano, it should never be louder than the one singing. It should never be louder than the one preaching, prophesying. Even when they do the little backup, when they back you up when you sing or when you preach and they back you up, I don't like all of that. I just want to be able to hear God clearly. But when you do that, I've seen people and it's so loud, it overpowers. No, if you are in tune with the spirit, there's something in you. The Holy Ghost is like, bring it down because God is speaking. But when it's not about God speaking, but it's about me being seen on the keyboard and me being seen on the drums, then the drums and the keyboard are louder than the voice of the Lord coming through the man of God or the woman of God. And it's not good. It's disrespectful. We have to learn worship. God, I love your word on today. We have to learn worship as sacred, and it is a place to create intimacy with God. The place where we learn to get beyond the veil, and we're not in worship long enough. Many a times we're not in worship long enough. I say it this way. It's just like when you was in the streets, if you was in the streets, not everybody was in the streets, but if you was in the streets, if you was one who used to drink or you was one who used to smoke, I ain't never seen nobody be like, I just want to get a little smoke. I'm just going to hit the blunt a little half of, that's it. No, people's trying to get high. Same thing with worship. People that want to drink, they trying to get drunk. They want to get two-fifths. Come on. They trying to get drunk. Same thing with worship. And we have to learn how to really ascend in worship. I remember one time at Makeover Transformation Church in Indiana, child, the worship was so high, couldn't nobody preach. But I believe that God touched every heart in the room. I believe that everybody got something out of that moment. We have to learn how to ascend, go higher in worship. And higher doesn't mean your voice got louder. See, it is the job of the worship leader to understand it is very important that I'm holding a sacred task here. We are ushering people into the presence of God. We are inviting the Lord into the place, into our hearts. Come on, we have to get this so that we can go. I promise deliverance, a lot of times deliverance is hard because we haven't really got through the realms. This is how I got free, y'all. This is how I got free. I was telling them last night, I got free from homosexuality through worship and prayer. Nobody laid hands on me. I just was talking to my father and I kept going and I learned how to ascend and ascend. Keep going. It's still something on me. Oh, God, I love your word. You have to learn how to really, it's still something on me. My God, come on. You got, hey, y'all can move on. There have been times when I'm trying to get a breakthrough, but the church was trying to move on with the program. I love God. And so that I got to, I've literally left sanctuaries and went outside on a parking lot because I'm almost there. I'm trying to get something. I need to get something. I realize I haven't reached where I'm trying to reach. And because we're so busy with a program, I'm so happy. I just bless God, y'all. I really do. I thank the Lord that he has literally made this my life. My schedule is God's schedule. I was looking, I've been studying the revivals of old. Okay, they would be in service for 5 hours sometime. We trying to be like, "Ooh, Lord, honey, what time is it? Because I got to do this, honey. I done told them I would be over there at 3 o'clock. Honey. How long else y'all going to be? How long else y'all going to be? We're going to be as long as till everybody's free. And we got to get back to that. Some people are in a rush, but some ain't. You know, I had a vision when I was in Thomasville worshiping the Lord. I had a vision. And the Lord showed me a homeless shelter, but it was in a church. And it reminded me of how when Hurricane Katrina and all these other natural disasters have happened, and people with mega churches didn't want to open their church doors. And the Lord showed me, okay, I see, showed me both sides. Well, you know, the church been open all of this time, you ain't came in. I mean, that's how people think, you ain't came in. And I get it, and it's true. Your church been open all of this time and you ain't came in. But God said, you have to learn how to use every opportunity. So what they should have done, God, I love your word on today. The Lord said, you let the people come in. You let them come in. You give them a place to sleep. You put some cots out, some whatever, some sleeping bags, whatever we got to do. But, baby, we going to have 24-hour praise. Everybody going to get to preach. Deacon James, you ain't preached in 2 years. Come on up. You got the 5 o'clock. And when you get done preaching, pass the mic to the next one. And when you get done preaching, pass the mic to the next one. Then you going to sing. Then you going to prophesy. We going to let the Spirit of the Lord. Because what that does is those that came in and they really want to come in and they just trying to get out of the cold or whatever, if they just came to get out of the cold, they gonna get a little Jesus. But if they came in for evil can't stay. Listen, evil wouldn't stay in that atmosphere because the atmosphere is now conducive for a miracle. God, I love your word. But because we're so close, we're so used to program and protocol, we think of things in the natural. Oh, help us, Holy Ghost. Jesus. Come on. We're going to have the homeless people come in. Praise God. Well, I don't want them. Honey, they might tear up. We don't know what they going to do. Chad, we're going to have 24-hour prayer. Everybody take a shift. Okay, you get you some rest, and then you come back. You be here bright-eyed and bushy-tailed in the morning. All right, this is why we got to learn how to last in worship. We have to learn how to last. Listen, it's so, God will give you a strategy for everything. You just got to be willing. I was like, you know what, Lord, that is just, wow. I never seen it, never heard it, but that's good. That's good. That's amazing. Yeah. Come on. We got sanctuaries with closed doors. Come on. We got all these preachers that are preachers in churches and apostles and prophets and evangelists and teachers, and they sitting on the pews. It's so much work to do. The Bible says the harvest is plentiful, but the laborers are few. What happened to the days when the church was open? Come on in. Ooh, glory. Man, we got to get back, y'all. Listen, I'm going to tell you, I can't wait, honey. My church and my house going to have speakers on the outside. Praise God. You ain't going to be able to ride past this church and don't hear God. Come on, it's all right. You ain't got to come in. Praise God. That's what we did. At our church, when we was in Indiana. Like I said, I started my church in my salon. And so I took a Bluetooth speaker and I had it outside. And every time we had service, I put that speaker on the outside, baby. And this on one end was a Mexican bar and grill. And it was a barbershop. And it was they had some other things. But honey, they got the word. Every Friday night, every Sunday, everybody walking past. And you know what would be interesting? Homeless people would come and they would sit on the curb and they would listen. We would invite them in. If they wanted to come, they would come. If they didn't want to come, they didn't come. We were in Clarksville, Indiana. But you're going to get this word. Come on. The word is free. We're going to get that. Come on. And so we have to get back to learning and asking God, Lord, teach me how to enlarge my territory. It's not about you having a bigger building. It's about you having a bigger vision in the little building that you got. Whew. I'm just trying to help somebody help somebody. Come on. And as we ascend in worship, the Lord will unlock. Yeah, somebody said they had a vision about speakers on the outside. Absolutely. I believe in it. Honey, listen. My God. God is so faithful. My aunt lives in the West End of Louisville, and there's a right next door to her. It's a crack house. And I said, oh, I wish. I said, listen, I was trying to, it's our family house. And there was a season that I was trying to get that house. I said, yes, I want to get that house. Child, I'm going to put speakers on all four corners of the house. Glory. I love God. Come on, the crack. The people ain't going to be comfortable smoking crack and hearing. They got to keep hearing the word and keep hearing the what? 24 hours. All you got is preach, pray, prophesying, and the glory. And I'm not talking about I love God. You don't love God? What's wrong with you? I like that. That's good. That's entertainment gospel to me. I'm talking about that real kind. Yes, my God. That holy of holies. That kind that's breaking through them strong tongues. My God. Come on. The yokes be not the kind of gospel music that they still play at the nightclub. Not that kind. I'm talking about the kind that's breaking through. Yes. My God. The kind with real oil on it. Yeah, that kind. Yes. Come on. Yeah. You have to create an atmosphere where evil is not welcome. It is not comfortable. It is not conducive. Come on. I like to make an atmosphere that is conducive for a miracle anytime God want to move. Listen. Hallelujah. We have to learn to create an atmosphere that is conducive for a miracle. That's why at weddings, a lot of times people at weddings, if the atmosphere is right, you might have been, you and your wife, you and your husband might have been in an argument, and then y'all walk into a wedding, and if the atmosphere is set right, then y'all getting all lovey-dovey. See how a miracle happened? Because the atmosphere was set. Atmosphere is very important. It is very important. It's very important. And so we have to learn to set the atmosphere and maintain the atmosphere. Okay. So when you come in, let's look at the place of worship as a pot of soup. Okay. So if it's a pot of soup, all right, a pot of broth, let me say it that way. If it's a pot of broth, nobody likes cold soup. So when you bring your worship in, are you putting in cold soup or are you putting in hot soup? Because you either bring the temperature up or you bring the temperature down. Which one are you doing in worship? Are you elevating the temperature or are you bringing the temperature down? It's time to come on up. It's time to elevate in our worship. Time to elevate. And I was saying this, I'm a worshiper. Listen, I love to get in the presence of God. I want to get beyond the veil. I'm trying to do it. I'm trying to hear, see, and do everything else that the Lord got for me in that moment. And so a lot of times I might come off as bossy in worship, but I'm not bossy. I can discern what the Holy Ghost is doing. I can discern if we have reached the right altitude for you to calm down yet. And so when you can discern that, I'm like, come on, come on, push. I still need you to push a little more. We need you to press. Come on, press, press, press. Come on, we got to go. We haven't reached it yet. Oh, we tired. I can't keep clapping. How long we standing? My feet hurt. I believe if you keep pressing, I believe if you keep going, my God, come on, your feet just might be healed in that moment. But because we have not learned, and we have to, let me help us. Oh, God, I love your word. I like hip-hop gospel. I like hip hop. I like gospel trap music. That's what I call. I like all of that. But if that's the only thing your children know, you are robbing them. God, I love your word on today. My God, you're robbing them of the gift of worship and intimacy with God. That's good. The hippity hop kind, I like it. But I have to also, and we have to also teach our children to elevate in worship. You got to teach them too how to get in. Sometimes you don't have music. That's why I don't wait for nobody to beat no drums for me to have a praise break. When it hit me, I don't need no music to shout because my worship is for real. This thing is, it hit me. Hey, my God. Come on. You don't have to wait for somebody to play a certain chord for you to dance. No, we ain't puppets. Jesus. We're not puppets. This is praise and worship. Thank you, Lord. We have to understand the importance of worship. Let's go to 2 Chronicles 20. 2 Chronicles 20. Hallelujah. So King Jehoshaphat had received a word that his enemies were surrounding him. Okay. King Jehoshaphat received a word that his enemies were surrounding him. So he called a fast and he called the people of God to gather, and they came together and they fasted. And that's the other thing that, you know, we struggle with that. We struggle with that. And we have to understand that fasting is important. It's a kingdom key. It's starving the flesh. Okay. It's starving the flesh. My God, help us, Holy Ghost. We got to understand that it's important to just obey God. When you obey the instruction of the Lord, you have to obey the instruction of the Lord without you running it past your carnal mind. Let me say it that way. You have to obey the instruction of the Lord without running it by your carnal mind, because your carnal mind is going to give you 5 excuses why you can't do it. Your carnal mind is going to tell you what the doctor said. Your carnal mind is going to tell you so on and so forth. But if you learn how to just obey the instruction of the Lord, we were talking about this last night. If we struggle in worship, just obey. If the worship leader or whoever's directing worship are leading in that moment, they say, lift your hands, just lift your hands. If they say, shout, just shout. Oh, well, I'm not that kind of person. It's a lie. Because these little dances that we see online, everybody, we got that in sync. Oh, we got the, okay, dip. All right, come on. We got that in sync. Now, how we going to be in sync in sin, and we over here talking about, I don't do it like that. You did it like that when they called it out in the world. Come on. And so it is with our children. The same way. My God. Come on, the kids, if they know how to do the same, the little hip-hop dance, they know how to do it good. Okay, put this leg wiggle and then dip back. They know how to do all that in the sanctuary. Okay, lift your hands and then wave your hand. The same thing, but we got excuses. When it comes to God, we have so many excuses, and we're not reaching the realms. And that's why we're going in one way and we coming out still the same. You got to be willing to go beyond your comfort zone. You got to be willing to go beyond your last praise. You got to be willing to go beyond the place where you're like, okay, this is good. You don't know. You got to learn how to get beyond the veil, because there's more. Hallelujah. There is so much more. Jehoshaphat was in a situation where his enemies were surrounding him. His enemies were surrounding him. 2 Chronicles 20:20. Early the next morning, the army of Judah went out in the wilderness of Tekoa. On the way, Jehoshaphat stopped and said, "Listen to me, all you people of Judah and Jerusalem. Believe in the Lord your God, and you will be able to stand firm." First of all, you got to believe in the Lord your God so that you're able to stand firm. Believe in his prophets, and you will succeed. After consulting the people, the king appointed singers to walk ahead of the army, singing to the Lord and praising him for his holy splendor. This is what they sang. "Give thanks to the Lord, for his faithful love endures forever." At the very moment, they began to sing and give praise. You know, I think it's beautiful. This text, they're getting ready to go to war. And they didn't say, do you got your swords? Do you got your shield? Do you got your gun? You got your knife? They didn't say that. Get your praise ready. We about to go to war. Glory. Get your praise ready, because we are about to go to war. Oh, God, I love your word on today. My God. At the very moment. Right when. That's what the word of God says. At the very moment they began to sing and give praises, the Lord caused the army of Ammon, Moab, and Mount Seir to start fighting amongst themselves. This is really funny, y'all. Listen, so I got a spiritual son, and he's a worshiper, he's a singer, and I fell into a out of nowhere in 2020. I've never had a seizure before in my life, and I fell into a seizure. And they said that I wasn't coming out of it. They couldn't wake me up. They wasn't bringing me. I wasn't coming out of it. And so he said, I got word. They called the church, let everybody know. They called everybody and let them know what was going on. He said, I wanted to be worried, but every time he has a problem and he calls me, I tell him two words. Same. Ernest, same. He said, and I wanted to be worried in that moment. He said, but I heard you in my ear. Sing, Ernest, sing. He said, and I began to sing. God, I love your word on today. Don't worry about me, worship. My God, if we ever learn how to allow worship to be second nature. You see, I'm sitting here today. God, I love your word. Come on. See, we got to understand the Bible says it when the church prayed. Come on. When the church began to use their weapons, come on. The weapons of our warfare are not carnal, but they are mighty through God to the pulling down of strongholds. The weapons of our warfare, come on, our worship. The weapons of our warfare are not carnal, but they are mighty through God to the pulling down of strongholds. Many of us are not able to pull the strongholds down because we have not learned how to ascend in worship. I'm trying to tell you to keep your mind. You just begin to worship right there in the middle of them acting crazy, right there in the middle of them cussing you out, right there when the bill don't look like it's going to be able to get paid, when the child is struggling, before you go in here to have a conversation that you don't think's going to go well. My God, come on. The Lord said, do not go to war without him. Don't do it. Invite him in. He comes in. He inhabits habitation, lives in home, comes in the house of. He inhabits, come on, the praises of his people. When you praise God, you open up yourself and your spirit to allow the spirit of the Lord to come in, to settle you, to strengthen you, to encourage you, to lift you up, to position you. Come on. See, so many things will be accomplished in worship that you can't accomplish in the natural. I'm trying to tell you, wake up in the morning. Your kids acting up, having bad days at school. Wake up in the morning. Wake them. You get up 15, 20 minutes early and just begin to worship. Sanitize the atmosphere. Begin to sing all over your house. Oh, glory to your name. Hallelujah. Begin to just worship the Lord. Hallelujah. Begin to just worship the Lord all in your house before you wake them up. First of all, get yourself right. You might have woke up on the wrong side of the bed. Then you want to go wake up the child and, come on, Johnny, get up. Well, Johnny's sick and tired of you. Wake him up like it. Come on. We have to learn how to use worship. Before you're getting ready to have a conversation with somebody that you don't think is going to go well, get into the presence of God. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. I said this and I stand on it. If you are a woman and you're married, and you're struggling with getting pregnant, before you and your husband are intimate together, get intimate in worship. Worship the Lord together. Come on, learn how to ascend in worship. And as you are ascending in worship and you begin to just praise the Lord together, baby, it's an oil that's going to flow. I'm trying to tell you, I believe it and you can't change my mind. Come on. Hallelujah. Because you're now inviting. You're trying to shift. See, people trying to get intimacy in their bedroom. If you learn how to get intimacy in the spirit of the Lord with your husband, with your wife, there's a new oil that is produced. You won't even want to be doing all kind of things that are outside of the will of God in your bedroom because you done purified. Come on, I'm trying to just do something that is beautiful. There's an exchange that is happening in making love with your husband or with your wife. I want that thing to be pure. We don't want to be doing nothing that's ungodly, bringing in all kind of crazy things in our bedroom. No, come on. I'm trying to help us. Worship creates intimacy. Thank you, Lord. Hallelujah. Help us, Holy Ghost. Hallelujah. God is so faithful. Right here in the middle of a bad situation, Jehoshaphat told the singers, get ready to sing. He called the praisers and the worshipers. Come on, we need the minstrels. That's what he said. Let me go back to 21. After consulting the people, the king appointed singers to walk ahead of the army. The worshipers went before the people with the swords and the shields. If you really understand, oh God, I love your word on today. Worship is a preparation. It's the place where the anesthesia, God, I love your word, the love of God, that's the anesthesia. The love of God is the anesthesia. It's the place where the anesthesia begins to flow in the room. Come on. We just read this. After consulting the people, the king appointed worshipers to walk ahead of the army. The army had the sword. Okay. The army had the sword. The sword is the word. The worshiper goes, the worship should go before the word. Come on. Because when we worship, that's when the anesthesia flows. It prepares us for the cutting away. The word of God is a two-edged sword, circumcising the flesh from the spirit. Come on. Oh, God, I love your word. This is the flow of service. This is the flow. Come on. Because when you truly get into worship, the Lord begins to speak. He begins to download. Somebody gonna get a download. Somebody gonna get a download in worship. He's gonna show a vision. He's gonna give you, he's gonna drop it in your spirit. He's gonna move on your heart. He's gonna give a prophetic word. He's gonna speak. He's going to say something because the word comes after the worship. And so if we have not got the worship, if we have not ascended in worship, then we may be just getting half of the word. We may not be getting the full word. There's so much that is accomplished in worship. There are things that you're trying to have drop off your life that only are going to be dropped off in worship. Ego, pride. Pride is a big one. A lot of times you feel that when you feel that ceiling and you're in worship and you feel that ceiling and you can't go above it, a lot of times it's pride. Because pride is the only spirit that will stand in the presence of God and not bow down. Woo! So that one right there, whenever, I'm in worship and I feel something and I'm sitting here and I don't want to praise God. I remember one Sunday I went to church and I was mad about something, about my bills wasn't paid or something. And so the whole worship is going on and I'm sitting there and I'm just sitting there with my arms folded crossed looking silly. Now, how you going to sit in the presence of God? And I remember, that was some years ago. That was probably about 10 years ago. But I remember it. And I want to say my pastor called out. He said something about it loudly. Praise God. Good. Say, call it out. Call it out. Because it's not good to sit in the presence of God. Come on. You came here. Not only is it pride, it's an arrogant spirit. Because you want to receive the word, but you don't want to give God what is due and just to him. It's pride and it's arrogance. And so when you see it correctly, you should be able to say, okay, all right. I'm sitting here in worship, the presence of God. Let me do something. I got to do something. Now this, I'm not about to sit here with pride and arrogance on my back, holding me down, chaining me to this chair, locking my tongue. No, I'm going to open up my mouth in Jesus' name. I can't do it. I don't feel comfortable. Either you can do all things through Christ who strengthens you, or you can't. Help us. He's been too good. He's been too good. Bless this woman of God. He's been too good. Power worship, the power of worship. The power of worship is not about how good it sounds. Am I moving in the spirit realm? Yes. So when my spiritual daughter, when she ministers in dance, I tell her all the time, you are ministering. When you minister in dance, you're not ministering for these people. They just get to sit in. on your private moment with you and the Father. That's it. That's the only people in the room. You don't, because entertainment means I came to give this to you. You didn't come to give this to them. I came to give my worship to the Lord. I came to minister unto the Lord. Hey, glory. Help us. But we've learned worship as a form of entertainment. See, the world calls praise and worship music entertainment. That's why they put it in the entertainment industry. This is entertainment. This is the gospel entertainment, baby. This ain't no entertainment. This is my way of life. A true worshiper is your way of life. I tell my daughter, if you only dance when you up front, you're now an entertainer. You're not a worshiper. You're an entertainer. You only dance when the spotlight is on you. You only dance when you're in the front of the crowd. You are not a worshiper. You are an entertainer. Because a true dancer, it's in you. Child, when I used to praise dance, baby, I'd be in the pews, honey. I'd be done hit somebody in the head. Oh, glory. Hey, my God, come on. Because it's produced out of the heart. And what is in you, it comes out. When the presence of the Lord fills the room. Some people are trying to figure out what your calling is. I heard it said this way, and it's so true. It's so true. When the presence of God is in the room, what are you inclined to do? When I feel the full presence of the Lord, I'm inclined to pray. I'm inclined to prophesy. Something begins to come up. It begins to bubble up. It begins to bubble up when the presence of the Lord is in the room. Some people, when the presence of the Lord is in the room, I'm inclined to dance. Some people, when the presence of the Lord, when I'm filled, I'm inclined to sing. My God, come on. Whatever is in you, when the presence of God fills the room. Come on. Hallelujah. It's not about taking a test online. What's my spiritual gifts? What do I do? How do I respond? The presence of God is in the room. My God, look, come on, we're here this morning. Maybe you in the presence of God began to get uncomfortable. The only thing uncomfortable in the presence of God is a demon, is his imps, is demonic things, dark things, evil things. So if you in the presence of God and you begin to get uncomfortable, you begin to get a really bad headache that you didn't have before worship started, you begin to... be like, huh, you're irritated by it. Oh, that means that thing is moving. Hey, and then you better learn how to press in. Okay, it's something moving. Come on. It's just like, hey, God, I love your word on today. My God, come on. You're in the presence of God and you begin to get uncomfortable. You begin to get, you get squirmish. Like I said, you get a headache. Oh, my God, that thing is manifesting in you. And that's good because when a baby is getting ready to be delivered, it begins to move and it begins to, come on, stretch out. Begins to get in the middle of the birth canal and come on down. So now it's your job to respond. And God, I love your word. That thing is coming up. And so God, I'm not leaving here with this thing still in me. So I got to press in. I got to come on and begin to lift up my hands. I got to begin to call on the name of Jesus. I got to begin to say, God, I love you. Lord, I thank you. Lord, deliver me. It's me. It's me. It's me, oh Lord. Hey, I'm standing in the need of prayer. Hey, you got to learn how to press in. Come on. You got to learn how to push. Come on. It's still in me. I feel this thing. Hey, my God. Come on. Depression is still on my back. Come on. Homosexuality is still on my back. Lust is still on my back. Gluttony is still on my back. I'm trying to get this thing. I got to push. I feel this thing. Something is on the inside of me. Oh, God, I love your word on today. And it is responding because the Bible says every knee shall bow. Hey, my God. Every tongue shall confess. So when the presence of the Lord is in the room, something in you, oh, I love God. Something in you is moving. It's something in you that's responding. And it is either the Spirit of God or it is the spirit of the devil. But something is responding. And either way, I'm not going to leave this way. I'm not going to leave this place the same. I'm not. Woo. See, we gotta teach this. I pray everybody takes this message and shares it with somebody, especially with your worship leaders. It's important for us to understand this because we thought it was just singing. We thought it was just songs. Watch how children, even children, when they begin to respond in the presence of God, there are some kids, they get antsy. Baby, it's something in them, that spirit of rebellion, move. They antsy, they, whoo, I'm ready to go. How long is it going to be, mom, hold? They get, because there's something responding in them. Woo, Jesus, the power of worship. Power of worship. Listen, women of God, don't you marry no man that don't know how to, when the presence of God is in the room and he ain't lifting his hands, baby, he should be loud as you or louder than you because he's the man. Man of God, don't you marry no woman that she don't got the, when she can't discern when the presence of God is in the room. Come on, she don't have no worship, child, because marriage requires worship. It requires worship because when you have an issue that is not well with your soul, if you go into worship and he go into worship, y'all going to come out with peace because the Lord going to speak to somebody and somebody going to submit to the word and bam, child, worship. Worship. It's important. You have to have it. The power of worship. The weapons of our warfare are not carnal, but they are mighty through God to the pulling down of strongholds. 2 Chronicles 20:22, the Bible says, at the very moment they began to sing. Oh my God. At the very moment they began to sing and give praise, the Lord caused. They sung and the Lord moved. They sung and the Lord moved. They sung and the Lord moved. Whew, glory. They caused the armies of Ammon, Moab, and Mount Seir to start fighting among themselves. The army of Moab and Ammon turned against their allies from Mount Seir and killed every one of them. After they had destroyed the army of Seir, they began attacking each other. So when the army of Judah arrived at the lookout point in the wilderness, all they saw was dead bodies lying on the ground as far as they could see. My God, not a single one of their enemies had escaped. I'm trying to tell you about God. They did not have to get their hands dirty. All they had to do was praise God. All they had to do was worship. All they had to do was learn how to ascend and last. Ascend and last. Because the Bible says that all of the armies start attacking each other, turning on each other. You got to learn how to hold. Hey, it's still a fight going on. You have to discern when it's still a fight going on. I can't stop yet because it's still a fight going on. I love God. Some delivery ain't one day. I'm so glad. Listen, we're going to be here we got 2 more nights here in Detroit. I'm so excited. Last night, we didn't really get through the realms like I wanted to, but we got to start. My sister is like her birth with her son. She was in labor 2 days, maybe 3 days. Yeah, she was in labor several days. My God, but we came out with a bouncing baby boy, and we're going to come out with a bouncing baby boy. That just is what it is. We're coming out. So sometimes it don't break on day one. I told y'all my testimony about how the Lord healed my body. It didn't break on day 2. It didn't break. But one thing I know, we got to get back to tarrying. That's what this is called. This is called tarrying. When you begin to get into the presence of God and you worship. Tarrying. Back in the old days, that's how you had to get the Holy Ghost. You had to tarry. Nowadays, we want everybody to just lay hands on me and fill me with the Holy Ghost. And that's good because it's in the Bible too. But it's a whole that you appreciate it more when you tarry for it. Tarry. Come on, keep going. Keep just calling his name. Keep calling his name. We don't have no power. The Bible says, stay here. Oh, help us, Holy Ghost. This is why the pastor is not supposed to have a full-time job. Yeah. Because in order to tarry some people, you got to be in, you might have to tarry with them for 5 hours. Listen, sister, I know you close to your breakthrough, but I got to go ahead and be at work, so I'm going to have to catch you tomorrow. This is why you're supposed to bring your seed to the house of God so the people of God can really, but the people of God got to get back to doing their job. But to be able to really spend that time doing what it is that God called them to do, to stand beside, to be a midwife. Come on, midwives don't leave till the baby's out. Oh, God, I love your word. The doctor can't leave in the middle, but because some of the people God got to have jobs, then they like, well, I want to stay here with you, but I'm not. I heard one woman's testimony. She went up to the altar, and I can't remember the beginning of it, but the long story short, she had been on drugs for like 15 years. And she said she went up to the altar and she was prayed for. She was slain in the spirit. She said she was passed out in that church for 8 hours. And she said when she got up, she didn't have a craving. She didn't have a desire. The Lord set her free. She didn't have to go through 21 days. She didn't have to go through the 12-step program. It was one step. The power of God hit her and she was out. But somebody had to sit there with her for 8 hours. So what happens when somebody is still trying to get their breakthrough, but we're in a rush? My God. The Bible says, stay here and tarry in Jerusalem until you are endued with power. When you tarry, when you get into the presence of God, you don't move from that until you feel a shift. And let me help us. If you were a heavy drinker, a heavy smoker, you did drugs in your past, and you were able to hold, people call it holding your liquor, you were able to drink large amounts, that means you have a big capacity. And so when the Holy Ghost comes in to fill the room of your heart, to feel that you, if you have a big capacity, it takes more for you. You got to keep drinking. You got to keep pressing. You got to keep tapping because I want to be filled. Come on. And so we got to be willing to stay in the presence as long as we need to stay in the presence. Stay right here in Jerusalem and tarry until you are endued, until you are filled with power. 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 Power to live holy. Power to stop masturbating. Power to forgive. Power to come out of sexual sin. Power, come on. Power to tread upon serpents' heads. Power to lay hands on the sick. Come on, power. Stay right here. Don't leave this moment until you feel something in you shift. Until you feel the weight lifted. Oh, glory to your name. Power of worship. Thank you, Lord. The power of worship. All they did was just worship the Lord. Told him how good he was, how amazing he was. Come on. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. Verse 25. King Jehoshaphat and his men went out to gather the plunder. They found the vast amounts of equipment, clothing, and other valuables, more than they could carry. There was so much plunder that it took them 3 days just to collect it all. And on the fourth day, they gathered in the Valley of Blessings, which got its name because the people praised and thanked the Lord there. And it's still called the Valley of Blessings till today. So what started out as what Jehoshaphat looking like he was getting ready to be surrounded by his enemies ended up being called the Valley of Blessings. That hard situation. That thing that you're facing, that court case, that rebellious child, that wayward son. Come on, your finances, your ministry, your marriage, your mind, whatever is going on in your life, there's still a place where if you learn how to ascend in worship, that the Lord will fight your battle. Hallelujah. That he will shift that thing. He will shift you. He'll give you strength to endure. He'll give you courage. He'll give you peace. Come on. He is God all by himself. He's holy. The Bible says they got the plunder. They got the spoils. They got all the blessings that the people got killed. The people got killed and they got all the blessings from the people that got killed. And it was so many blessings. It was so many things they walked away with. It took them 3 days to carry it all. And none of them men didn't lose their lives because they obeyed God. Because they obeyed God and all God told them to do was just praise, just worship. That was the word, just praise. Don't be afraid. Praise me, worship me, set your affections. God is calling us to truly trust him in this season And in order to trust him, you have to have a worship life. You have to have a prayer life. You have to have communication with the Father. Thank you, Lord. Hallelujah. Because it's where you get your strength. It's where you get your courage. It's where you get your courage. Hallelujah. We go from faith to faith and from glory to glory. And it's time to ascend. And that is why the Lord is anointing the ear of the psalmist in this season, because there are new songs. Many of us, we sang the same songs. We got everybody know the songs. And I was talking about this last night. Some demonic things in your life are comfortable with that song, so they're not going to come out. Because they know the song more than they sang the song with you while you sang the song. So some, there has to be new songs, new melodies, new lyrics. You got to switch it up sometime. You got to switch up your praise and worship music. If you done been masturbating and singing this song for 10 years, that song ain't got no effect on you. It ain't moving nothing in you. Okay, praise God. If they play the song at the nightclub, I mean, I don't know how we gonna know if they play at the nightclub unless we was there. But I remember when I used to go to the nightclub, they would play "I Love God." You don't love God, what's wrong with you? They would play Stomp. They would play Kirk Franklin Stomp. If that Mustang got as much oil as we thought it had on it. Because we're in a room full of demons and this song is playing, it ain't nothing, and everybody's just, oh, they dancing to it. Hallelujah. I love God. The power of worship. Oh, Lord, we thank you for your word on today, oh God. Thank you, Lord, that you're holy. You're righteous. You are the King of Kings and you are the Lord of Lords. And mighty are the works of your hands. We thank you for the privilege and the honor to come before your throne of grace. Lord, we bless your name. Your faithful love endures forever. Hallelujah. May we learn to meet you in the realms, going higher and higher, desiring your will for our life. Thank you, Lord. Desiring your way, God. May we learn your ways. May we learn to be filled with your spirit. And may we learn to not come out of your presence until it has accomplished everything of which it was called to accomplish. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. In your presence, there is the fullness of joy. In your presence, depression is destroyed. Anxiety has to flee. May we learn your presence and not the presentation. We've learned the presentation of the gospel, but may we learn your presence, your purifying presence, your holy presence. Thank you, Lord. Hallelujah. Bless your name, oh God. There's restoration in your presence. Hallelujah. There's peace in your presence. Thank you, Lord. Glory to your name. You're faithful, oh God. Hallelujah. There's healing in your presence. There is deliverance in your presence, oh God. Hallelujah. May we not have a gimme gospel in our heart. May we not just want you to gimme, 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 gimme. And we're not even willing to bring our worship. We're not even willing to press and get beyond the veil for worship. But even when we were in the streets and somebody was going to fight somebody, we're trying to push through to get to that person to fight. We know how to push through. We repent on today, God. We know how to push through everything else. But may we have the burden to push through worship until we reach those altitudes in you, God, where deliverance happens, healing happens. Thank you, Jesus. Elevation. Restoration. Hallelujah. Lord, we thank you. You're so good, God. Hallelujah. Touch every heart and mind on today, God. That tuned in, may this word fall on fertile ground. May it reap a harvest 30, 60, 100-fold Unlock the keys to the kingdom, the mysteries of heaven to us, oh God, even as we worship you in spirit and in truth. May we not just live, may we not just sing worship songs, but may we live them. Hallelujah. Lord, we bless your name. You're good. Your mercy endures forever. Thank you, Jesus. Praise your wonderful name. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Glory. In Jesus' name we pray. Oh, Jesus. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Glory to your name. God, we thank you. You're faithful. You're faithful, God. Thank you, Lord. Revelation comes in worship. Hallelujah. Revelation comes in worship. The Lord will reveal things to you about yourself and about others. Hallelujah. Glory to your name. Praise your wonderful name, oh God. Thank you, Jesus. Glory. Hallelujah. Oh, yes, God. Yes, Lord. Hallelujah. Yes, God. Woo, praise your name. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. As we learn the presence of God, you won't be really so quick to leave. When you really learn the presence of God and you actually get a taste and a touch from the Lord, you won't be trying to fly out the church doors trying to get out. You'll be trying to be like, dang, do we got to leave? I just want to stay a little longer because this presence is so sweet. It's so filling. It's so refreshing. Intimacy is beautiful. Hallelujah. It's like when a husband and wife really love each other. He's like, I don't want to go to work today. I just want to lay here with you, babe. Come on. That's the same feeling. But amplified when it comes to when you learn the presence of God. You're like, oh, no, I don't want to leave yet. I'm just going to stay right here a little longer. Hallelujah. Yes, God. Learning how to bask in his presence. Get calm, get still, reverence his presence. Teach your children to reverence his presence. When the Spirit of God is moving, sit down. You don't do all that moving around. We ain't doing all of that. Sit down, let the Lord touch you. Just sit there and hold your arms open. Just be ready to receive whatever the Lord is dropping in your heart and in your life. We have to teach children to reverence the presence of God. It's okay if they don't know. Some people don't bring their kids to church. I don't bring my kids to church because they don't know how to act. They're not never going to know how. And it's not about acting. Don't teach them to act. Teach them. Train them. Okay, this is what we do. No, you got to sit back down. No, we're standing up now. Okay, we're doing this now. We're doing train. Retrain means you got to keep repeating the same thing over and over and over and over. Train. But it's okay. It's why the Bible says love is patient. Because you got to be patient enough to keep on telling them. No, we going to church. We're not going to not go to church because Johnny don't know how to sit down. The Lord told me this. If your children learn how to sit in the presence of God in the church, they'll know how to sit in the presence. They'll know how to sit in school. They have to learn how to reverence authority. God is the highest authority. Thank you, Lord. Ooh, Jesus. My God. Ooh, glory. Oh, yes, God. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. The Lord called David a man after his own heart. David was a worshiper. He danced up out of his clothes. He didn't care what the people thought. I got to get into the presence of God. Come on, I got to hear my Father. I got to feel his presence. I done been out in war. See, this is what makes people bitter. If you're going to live for God, you better have a worship life. Because you fight battles every day. You get people throwing arrows. The devil's throwing arrows every day. Weapons form every day. Worship stops the bleeding. Hallelujah. Come on. Worship helps you not bleed out. That's where you give it to God. Listen, I done got cut. I done got cut, so I got to go in so I don't bleed out. I got to get into the presence of God. I got to get where the healing is because I don't want to bleed out. Ooh, Jesus. But see how I'm not a worshiper. I don't do that. I'm not doing that. So now you're not allowing the Lord to stop the bleeding. You bleed out. Oh, praise your name. Woo. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord, for speaking on today. Oh, glory. I love God. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord. Hallelujah. 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 ADHD, LMNOP, and any of these other ABCs that they trying to put on our children, it can be destroyed in worship. It's not a pill. The weapons of our warfare, the Bible says, we just read yesterday, the war is in the mind. That's where ADHD and LMNOP and everything else that they saying is still in the mind. It's about that mind. It can be destroyed in worship. Hallelujah. Whew. My God. Thank you, God. Hallelujah. Oh, hallelujah and amen. Thank you, Lord. The presence of the Lord is so sweet right now. Hallelujah. I pray this word encouraged you. I pray it strengthened you on today. My God. Someone said they just walked out of the worst doctor's appointment that they just had. But in worship, it can be destroyed. Because the doctor don't have the final say. That's the beautiful part. So you don't have to receive it. I don't care what they say. When we take it to the doctor that made the doctors. Hallelujah. If we learn how to create an atmosphere of worship, it's the anointing that destroys the yoke. Thank you, Lord. Hallelujah. Praise your wonderful name. It's the anointing that destroys the yoke. Hallelujah. You know, let me tell y'all this beautiful vision that the Lord gave somebody. I always say, when I'm worshiping, the Lord just put in my heart, I say, I always ask God, as we worship in this place, God, I believe that you are in the world. Moving as we worship in this place, I believe that you're going to the crack house. I believe that you're going to the strip club. I believe that you're visiting a jail cell. I believe that you're going over in Africa. I believe you're going over in India. I believe as we're worshiping in this place, I believe. And one of my aunties called me and said she had a vision. And she said in the vision, I was in a room and I was playing the piano, and we was just a bunch of believers, and we was in the room and we were worshiping. And she said, I was playing the piano, and she said, I was singing, and we were all singing something that we all knew. And then she said, I began to sing prophetically, and nobody didn't know that, so they just got quiet. And she said, the glory filled the room and the fire of God fell, and people began to just begin to worship. And she said, it was so thick, all I could do was just sit there with my head down. And she said, she began to weep. And she said, as the glory was moving in the room, she said, the Lord began to show her visions all over the world of people being healed, people being delivered. As we were in that place worshiping, I said, my God, that's my heart. That's what I always tell God. You have to understand how to label your worship. We're not just up here singing songs. Power of worship. And that's just what happened. So we're here in Detroit, and we were worshiping, and I just began to ask the Lord to dispatch angels all through the neighborhood as we were worshiping the Lord. And the woman of God whose house we are at right now, she said, my street ain't never this quiet. And I said that myself. I mean, I don't know, because this is my first time here. But I said, my God, it is so quiet. I had to take one of the women of God home, and I was like, it's so quiet, this is weird. I'm like, well, maybe it's Tuesday night, maybe it's because it's 1 o'clock in the morning. But it was like on the Christmas book, not a creature was stirring, not even a mouse. And she said, listen, she said, it's never this quiet, but as we worshiped in this place, come on, power of worship. It's time out for being an entertainer. Either you're going to be a worshiper or not. It's time to worship with clean hands. Hallelujah. Worshippers are the anesthesiologists in the church, in the operating room of heaven. You got to have clean hands. You wouldn't let nobody operate on you with dirty hands. So even for my leaders, you can't have worshipers leading and you know that they living dirty. You know they living foul. You know the Lord has showed you they're living in sin. You got to sit them down. We ain't putting you out of the church, but you got to go to the pews for a season. You got to let the Lord process you, because you're opening doors for other people. People come to church, their spirit is open. They want to come and get a touch from the Lord. And you got homosexuals leading the choir. My God, come on. People leaving out of the sanctuary with homosexuality on them. They didn't even come with that. My God. Oh, help us. No condemnation. No condemnation. No condemnation. Come on. We really have to have clean hands, y'all. Come on. Just as bad as gluttony. Just as bad as fornication. Just as bad as lying, cheating, and stealing. It's all still true. It's all still true. You might say, well, I ain't going to have no choir. Well, that's all right. I'd rather you have no choir for a season. And then when they all get delivered and they come back, baby, woo, glory. Child, we'll have, you see how YouTube is working just fine. Praise God. Because it's important that at the end of the day, the Lord will use whatever he uses, because he's God. Don't get it twisted. I'm not saying the Lord can't use anybody. He'll use anybody. He said he'll make a rock cry out. So he can use anyone. But we're trying to get to those places where we operate with clean hands on purpose. That it's our desire. Hallelujah. Oh, praise your name. This is, someone asked who this is. This is Rick Pitino. What is the name of the album? It's a whole album that he's got. But the first one was called You Restore Everything. And the one we're listening to now is called We're Open. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. I mean, Rick Pino, P-I-N-O. Hallelujah. Oh, come on. Woo, Jesus. A true worshiper, you don't need nobody to tell you what to say and what to sing. Because, hey, this is my life. I have lived this thing. I done seen the Lord's hand move in my life. I'm in my word. I'm studying. The Lord is ministering to me. He's giving fresh downloads. Oh, glory. We got to get back to the anointed psalmist. Who doesn't have a script? We got to get back to the anointed psalmist who don't have a script. I'm not on script. My God, I promise that's what the Lord has really been doing. I said, Lord, I don't got no notes. What we going to talk about? I don't know. Just begin to worship. As you begin to worship, I'm going to give my people what I want to give my people. Thank you, Lord. Hallelujah. 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 Thank you, God. I'm full, y'all. Hallelujah. Glory to your name. Hallelujah. Oh, praise your wonderful name. Hallelujah. I pray the word encouraged you on today, and I pray it strengthens you. I pray you receive something today. Hallelujah, from this word. If you're watching on TikTok, it will be available on YouTube a little later today. It'll be called The Power of Worship. All glory goes to God. All glory, all honor goes to God. Hallelujah. I didn't have no message prepared. I just said, okay, Lord, what are you saying to your people? Thank you, Lord. I believe the Lord showed up and gave a word that touched every heart that tuned in today. I believe everyone got what they needed. Hallelujah. I love you all. So we are still here in Detroit. We'll be here tomorrow. And, yeah, I'll be leaving on Friday. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. My God. Whew. Worship helps you deal with rude people. I'm going to help you. It'll help you. It'll help you. Worship even, yeah, it'll help you. Oh, it sanitizes their heart. See, worship, what it does is it cleanses their heart. So sometimes it's still some in us. That some roll in the neck. But worship, it gets it out. So when they come, you just be like, I don't even got nothing for you. Glory. It's all I got. Praise God. I don't even got nothing. Because my heart is empty. It's filled with the love of God. And that's where we're going. Hallelujah. Amen. I love you all. Be encouraged. Have a good day on purpose. Know if God be for you, he's greater than the world against you. If you have been texting me, I've just been super busy. I've been super busy. We've been traveling. Hallelujah. We was up. I'm sorry I missed my 7 a.m. this morning. Y'all, we was up at till I thought it was 4. We actually were up till about 4:45 just talking about the word of God with the Bibles open till 4, almost 5 o'clock this morning. So when my clock went off at 5, I said, Jesus, I just laid down. I tried to get up, but it didn't happen. And I had actually already been up since 5 the day before, so I had almost been up 24 hours. So I didn't make it at 7, but I love you all. Prayerfully, we will be able to be on at 7 in the morning. And we'll see what it is that the Spirit of the Lord is saying to the church. I love you all. Be encouraged. Know if God be for you, he's greater than the world against you. Have a blessed day on purpose. Have a blessed day on purpose. And I hope to see you all soon. God bless.